All right, next up we've got Ahmed and Gabriella. Hello.
Hey, Chris. How are you doing?
Excellent. Good to see you.
Yeah, likewise. Thank you for inviting us to speak with you guys again.
Absolutely. So let's start with a little bit about yourselves.
Yeah, of course. My name is Ahmed, and I'm one of the heads of CG at Framestore. We predominantly use Houdini as our main tool in our department, so this is why we're here speaking with you guys today.
And I'm Gabriella, and I'm the head of grooming and CFX at Framestore as well. And I spend most of my time combing and creating those creatures in Houdini as well.
Excellent. So what are you going to be talking about today?
So we're going to be going through some of the work we did for two television shows, two quite different shows, and we created two quite different creatures for those. I'm going to give a more kind of overview of the production and how we created that work, and Gabriella is going to go into the more technical side. Gabby, would you like to give us a bit of an overview?
Yeah, so I'll be covering most of the challenge we encountered while producing those creatures and how we develop tools and new setups using Houdini to overcome them.
Excellent. Well, I can't wait. So let's jump in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Ahmed, and I'm one of the heads of CG at Framestore in London. Joining me today is Gabriella, who's our head of Groom and CFX. So coming up in this presentation, we're going to take an in-depth look at some of the work that went into creating two very different creatures for two very different TV shows. First, we'll take a look at how we brought a Scottish red stag to life for the Netflix drama series The Crown. And after that, we're going to take a look at how we created the ringtail lemur for HBO's His Dark Materials. Both of these creatures had their own set of unique challenges, and they presented a fantastic opportunity for us to further develop our custom creature tools and workflows. But before all of that, let's first take a look at our department's showreel to kick us off. Okay, cool. So as you could probably see from the showreel, our department works across all kinds of different media. With the rise of big budget episodic work, as well as a huge appetite for media-rich immersive entertainment, the scope of the type of work that we do has massively expanded over the past 5 years or so. So television, immersive, and advertising, those are the three main avenues of the type of work that we do. But every now and then, we also get a chance to work on feature films, such as the James Bond title sequences or the recent BAFTA award-winning horror film, His House. Right now, our department's probably hovering around somewhere between 60 to 70 CG artists. And the majority of those artists use Houdini as the main tool to create all of this wonderful work. Okay, now on to the main show. So for the Crown, we started our work in February last year. This was probably about a month before the global pandemic hit us hard in London, and we went into full national lockdown. So figuring out the new working arrangements of working from home was, of course, challenging at first. But we persevered, and with huge thanks to our systems and tech support engineers, as well as our infrastructure teams, we were able to carry on working without any major dips in our productivity. We went on to deliver work across all 10 episodes of season 4, and our work saw us gaining one win and two nominations at the VES Awards this year, which we're extremely proud of. As you can see from this breakdown reel, the bulk of the work that we did was, let's say, the more invisible VFX type work. So lots of environments, set extensions, map paintings, digital cityscapes, airplanes, boats, and so on. The Crown as a series, it's a drama series that's very much grounded in reality. So much so, in fact, that my wife even jokes that it's actually a documentary series. So with that in mind, we went into this with the idea that our VFX must live within this same grounded reality. It's not a fantasy series where the audience are expecting to see VFX work or something fantastical. So if our work stood out from the plate, it would immediately take them out of the story and it would jeopardize the drama being played out on the screen in front of them. So as I mentioned, there was a really wide gamut of the type of work that we did across the whole season. But one of the most challenging things, and for me, one of the most rewarding tasks that we had on this series was to create a full CG stag. Again, our aim and our goal here was to create something that convinced the viewers that what they were seeing on the screen was absolutely real, rather than a good digital imitation. It's a goal that's really difficult to achieve, especially on a limited TV budget. But for us, this goal was vital for the integrity of the show. And in November last year, when this episode finally released on Netflix, there was a huge uproar on Twitter and social media where lots of people believed that they actually witnessed a real animal being shot and hunted down during the episode. So just judging by the online reactions, it seems that we achieved this goal. For me personally, my involvement was as a creature supervisor on this particular episode. And by the time I joined the show, we already had a full edit of the stag sequence that we were going to be working on. And the edit that we had had this wonderful 2D animatic that was already comped into the footage. This edit, along with the animatic, was a fantastic way for us to quickly get a good understanding of the challenges ahead that we faced, both with the asset and with the animation. It was an excellent guide for the animation to help us better understand the type of performance that we needed to get out of our stag. We saw that our stag featured in one of the very first shots of this episode, so we knew that if it didn't look right, the whole episode would have started off on the wrong foot. Not only that, the opening shot was particularly long. It was almost 500 frames in length. filmed in broad daylight, and I knew that we were delivering this at 4K resolution. So there was really absolutely nowhere to hide. There were wide shots as well as close-ups of the stag, so we knew that this asset had to hold up at all kinds of distances. Of course, with every project, gathering and studying references is one of the most important parts of the work that we do. And from seeing the 2D animatic that was provided to us by the client, we knew that we needed to see our stag doing all kinds of different things. The stag was going to be walking, he was going to be grazing, he was going to be roaring, running, he was going to get shot, and then he was going to clamber up again, he was going to jump across the stream. So we knew that our CG stag was going to be put through its paces, and that every aspect of the asset was going to be scrutinized and pushed to its limits. So looking at all the different types of actions that the stag was going to do through the sequence, we went off and did lots of research and gathered all kinds of reference footage, trying to match it to the type of actions that the stag was going to do. Again, we saw that it's a hunting sequence. We knew that the stag was going to get shot, so we had to find lots of reference and study what stags do when they get shot, which was quite difficult to do for the soul, but you know, it was a necessary part of our day-to-day job. All right, onto the CG. Here you can see one of the very first iterations of our model. VFX work is all about iterations. The more time you can spend iterating on an asset, the better it will become. Always scrutinizing and comparing it to references, adjusting the broad shapes and refining details. It's often tricky to find out what the underlying geometry looks like on especially furry creatures, creatures with long fur. Certainly around the neck area, our stag had lots and lots of iterations and adjustments along the way. You can see here we also sculpted the fur volume to help us understand how much space the fur would occupy around the neck. There was lots and lots of back and forth between modeling and groom and looking at references and judging photography. Here you can see we adjusted the height. Here's an early look dev render of the underlying skin texture. Constantly adjusting, constantly iterating. As soon as we had a rig, we would put the stag in a pose, so it's not just a static kind of, let's say, a T pose. First versions of the groom. Here's our stag next to a digital human, just so we can see how it fares in terms of size. Always adjusting, always iterating, improving textures, improving shaders, improving the model. Like I say, the more you iterate, the more you scrutinize, the more you compare to references, the better result that you will get in the end. This is one of the later turntables that we did. You can see here the asset is already starting to look pretty good. So it's one thing getting our stag to look real as a static render. It's another task entirely to carry on this realism as the model starts to animate and deform. Through studying reference footage, again, of course, we could see that there's lots of muscles and skin deformation that translate up into the fur, and this determines how the top surface moves and behaves. You can see there's lots of muscles firing and tensing, as well as skin sliding and areas of fat bouncing. This render here that we're looking at, this is, I'd say, is probably about halfway through the CFX development. So there's already lots of nice things happening. You know, you can see the skin sliding around the back knee. You can see there's some muscle jiggle. The fur here, we'll talk about this in a minute. This still needs a lot of work. You can see it's lost a lot of its shape. It's just gone completely flat and limp. But in terms of how the surface of the geometry is behaving, this is already starting to look very promising. here's that same render again without the fur. Of course, we were making a photoreal stag, so he had to be fully and completely anatomically correct. You can see here that the area around where the knee meets the torso was starting to work quite well. This area, for me, I think is notoriously difficult to get right in CFX. This is where the knee almost completely disappears into the abdomen as the leg comes up, as the creature animates. You can see the skin sliding around the ribcage. Lots of really cool deformations happening to sell the realism that we're trying to achieve. So besides the skin, it was equally as important to get the fur deforming in a natural way. How we deform our fur has been an area of development that's been of particular interest to me for many, many years now. Especially in the workflow of how the dynamics drive a static groom and how the simulated guys deform this groom. So with every creature project that we get through the department, we try to push this workflow and further develop and iterate and improve on our tools that do this. With the stag, we knew that he had this long mane of fur around his neck. We knew that he lived up in the Scottish Highlands, where it's a bit damp and rather windy. So we started to work on a way to ensure that the clumps that we sculpted into the groom kept their shape as we started to deform the fur with all the simulated guides. Here you can see that our deformer was starting to work, but at closer scrutiny we could see that the tops of the clumps were still opening up, so we still had a bit more development and work to do. Of course, with any technical development, you come across little hiccups and glitches where things just break and don't work as they should. But, you know, we persevere and eventually we started to get some really nice results. You could see here, we really pushed the sim. We exaggerated the movement of the sim to help us scrutinize and really judge how our deformer was performing. In this render here, this is probably a bit more of a realistic and natural behavior of how we'd expect the fur to move. And again, you know, you could see that the clumps are really holding their shapes really nicely. So this is one of the shots that we were working on. You can see here some work in progress flipbooks exploring the different fur and wind settings that we were applying to the shot. Again, always iterating, always refining. Here's a beauty render of that same shot that we were just looking at. You can see there's some really nice deformations happening around the mane of the fur, and this deformation carries on across the whole body. You know, we didn't limit our dynamics just to the long fur, which we felt helped with the realism. And further to that, you can see on the antlers there's some nice effects elements of foliage and grass that was stuck to the antlers that kind of slides and flutters and blows off in the wind. It's all of these little things that help sell the realism and convince the viewer that they're looking at the real thing. So at this point, I'm going to pass over to Gabriella so she can explain further some of the more technical aspects of how she created the groom and some of the tools that we developed for our stag. But before that, let's take a look at a quick breakdown reel of this magnificent beast that we've created. Thank you.
Hey, my name is Gabriella, and I'm the head of grooming and CFX at Framestore. I'm here today at FMX to talk a bit about the creatures we've been doing. And I'm going to focus especially on the grooming and character effects that we did on some of our creatures. I'm going to start with our stag that we made for the season 4 of The Crown. So stag has quite a complex grooming, especially because it's a super dense groom. So we are talking about 15 million hairs and around 200 million segments. So without the systems we currently have to deal with heavy grooms, it would be impossible to render that without using a huge amount of memory. Apart from this technical aspect, this groom was very complex in the artistic side because it had like some special characteristics like a semi-wet fur and has this big mane around the neck that you need like very specific movements and reaction. So whenever you look at Stag, the first thing you're going to notice is this massive mane around his neck. So this was one of the areas that I dedicated at least half of the groom time to get it right. Talking about this amount of segments that we have, it's worth mentioning that we use a special way to calculate how many segments per hair we have. So it takes many things into account. One of them is the length. So the longer the hair is, more segments it will have. So a very tiny small hair on the face will probably have like 3 segments. And whenever you go to the body, you can go over to as many as you need, like 20, 50, whatever. Depends on how long it is. But it also takes another thing into account, which is the curvature of the strand. If you have like a straight line and some curvatures around, it's pretty much just going to add more points on the curvature, not on the straight line. This can reduce our segments count by half, actually. So the way we generate guides is very artistic driven. So I like to comp guides a lot. And I like to have control of every specific guide and what direction and what flow this guide will have. So I pretty much comb guide per guide until I have the full guide set. So that's the way I like to work with. You can see more details how I do this approach if you watch the tutorial series I made for Berry Bacon. It's called Grooming Berry Bacon. On this course, especially on part one, I focus on explaining a lot how this manual process of combing guides is made. And that's the actual core of my groom. I would say, like, if you don't get a nice combing, you most likely won't have a nice groom in the end. So let's talk a little bit about our groom shading. To start with, it was rendered using Arnolding, and it has quite a complex shading network behind the scenes, especially for the groom. One thing that's worth mentioning is that we got a custom tool to actually define what is the fur color. So we don't actually use like color textures to render the groom. This tool is called Color Maps, which is also known in some places as probabilistic maps. So the idea behind that is that instead of like painting colors, we paint the probability of a hair is going to be like a black hair, a white hair, a brown hair. So we actually like paint a per color map and then we combine them and normalize those attributes in order to create probability of which hair is going to be what. Now on this slide, you can see on a two color scheme how it works. So whenever we paint like a .5 on white and .5 on black, in this area half of the hairs are going to be white and half of the hairs are going to be black. Whenever we add more colors, this equation starts becoming a bit more complex, but it creates this natural blending between them. So you won't have like a gray color between white and black, you're going to have like half of each color. And this is more realistic than actually a gray color on the intersection between them. So for Stag, we actually had like 6 main colors. These colors are not exactly colors, they're just masks. They're used to drive the shader. On the shader, we could actually assign any color we want. And you can also put textures on top of that. So you can have like a melanin texture that will work within this mask that you painted So it is a combination of many factors, and this is quite powerful because it gives a lot of freedom to customize your network in a very fine level. So I can have this main probabilistic mask that is driven by a melanin texture map, has also some root-to-tip mappings and a per hair color variation. We also have extra masks for where it's muddy and on the areas that is covered in blood, and also use some extra masks to drive this wetness. If you check our whole network, it's quite a massive network, so it's a bit scary to look at, but it's actually not that complicated. I mean, if you think that this single network drives the whole color of the fur of every single hair, that is not complex at all. Well, now I'm going to talk a little bit more about how we process our grooms. This groom is not processed on a single thing. We actually process this in parallel. So we break it into multiple pieces, and each piece is processed by a different machine. So before that, we used to take like 1 hour to process a full groom, from generating guides to generating clumps, noises, and final material assignment. Right now, with this parallel function, we can cut this time to 5 minutes if you want to. It uses the logic of divide and conquer. So instead of trying to deal with this issue as a single big issue, we deal with that as a smaller problems. Then when you solve every single small problem, you solve the big one. And this also allows us to not have memory restrictions anymore. Can actually have as many hairs as we want, and we know it's going to render. We are not going to run out of memory. This is not a problem anymore. I can have a super complex room without being afraid of it extrapolating the actual memory specifications that we got. Apart from processing the groom in parallel, we also do this at render time. So it uses the same logic, but it also does this in the rendering scene. So we make use of Arnold procedurals to actually break the groom in many pieces and process each one of these procedurals independently, merging back during render time, and allow us to have things like prune when we render like just a small percentage of hair. Instead of like loading everything and deleting, it simply won't load what it doesn't need to load. This is much more efficient than loading everything and deleting. Another very important tool that we have is called Hair Deformer. So it's the core of all our grooms, especially when they have dynamics. That's it, because we don't regenerate every single hair for every single frame. So instead, we just generate all the hairs for the rest pose, and then we use a deformer to actually make those hairs follow the guide's movement. This hair deformer, we've been working on it for maybe 3 years already, and it started as one setup, and we keep like modifying and improving from project to project. Every time we found like a different groom that the previous system was not good enough to keep the same quality whenever it's deforming. For this, stag was one of those projects that we had to actually grab everything and start over again. That's because it was the first groom that we had that was semi-wet, and we need those clumps to be tight and like move the guides around without opening, not even a little bit. Because if they open a little bit, all this wet feeling that you get, it was going to be lost. In order to achieve that, we wrote a whole set of new tools to actually detect clumps and make sure you have a guide exactly on the middle of that. And then have a very robust deformation algorithm to make sure that those clumps are following around those guides very nicely. Our first deformer algorithm is right now integrated into Houdini. So if you add like a guide deform node and you set the algorithm method to barycentric, you're actually getting like the first idea that we got. That was a partnership that we did with SideFX a couple of years ago, and now it's finally available for you. Another big thing behind Stag was the small pieces of geometry got attached to it. So we got a layer of blood, a layer of fine pieces of grass, a layer of dirt, a layer of mud, and a layer of water droplets. Each one of these geometries scattered around has very specific properties. So for the mud, you want it to actually stick on top of the clumps, like a volumetric envelope, while a piece of grass, you want it to stick on the hair without really stretching or deforming much. This setup we got has the ability to scatter all these different types of geometries at the same time. They also have their own deformer sets. Whenever the hairs are moving around, they're going to follow the movement with the same level of precision. So you can see how much of these elements are on the same type. Most of them are pretty much invisible, but whenever you get a close-up and you see those tiny bits, it's the little cherry on the top that adds this extra level of realism that you will find on an animal or nature. To create the dynamics for Stag, we used Vellum in conjunction with a custom tool to create wind fields on SOP. So the way it works is on a SOP level, so on a real-time level, we are actually going to cast rays, and they are going to detect the stag presence, and they are going to bend those rays around. And once we feed this velocity fields to Vellum, it also adds noises on top, and this creates our wind field. The nice thing about this is that you can have a real-time preview in our viewport without shooting it to simulation. So you can play blast in real-time and see what direction the wind is going, what the movement is it's doing, what's the intensity of the wind before feeding into the simulation. Once it gets to simulation, it's going to inherit this movement as a velocity field and calculate all collisions and stretchiness and hair properties around that. This combination of two is the key for the wind effect that we got on Stag, especially on the close-up shots. For this Stag project, we created a brand new muscle setup. So before that, we used infinite elements over for our creatures, but then we wanted to try Vellum on it for the first time. And Vellum worked really well, especially because it's way faster. Our muscle setup has some stages, being bones the first one, and then a muscle scene, an inner rope, a fascia simulation, and finally a skin simulation. The bone stage is simply to import the alembic animation, and then it does some checkups and correctives to avoid bones being stretched or being deformed in an unrealistic way. The muscle setup, all muscles are imported and simulated at the same time. The muscles were hand sculpted, and they are correctly positioned and attached on Houdini. The inner rope and fascia simulation were super important for the skin sliding effect that the stag has, and it also adds this fat simulation on top to help create a bit more bouncing and realism. The last stage is the skin deformation, so it runs on top of everything else, and it helped create some fine details and another layer of skin sliding and some wrinkles. For the close-up shots, we used an extra simulation on the face. This was to create these organic movements around mouth and cheeks and around the ears. So this creates those fine wrinkles and those subtle movements helps put the next level of detail for the close-up. You can see our little stag look with everything attached on it and on a movement on this heavy wind. This is a creature I'm very proud of be part of the team, and everyone was simply amazing in it.
Thanks, Gabriella. As you can see from this credits list here, we had an incredibly small team of artists working on this asset. With myself supervising all aspects of the stag, alongside with Gabriella and three other artists working on this asset, you know, creating the groom, modeling, texturing, look dev, rigging CFX, and so on. And we also had just four animators working across the 13 shots which played out in this episode. As a team, it was absolutely a work of passion, and I think it shows in the end result, and everyone is extremely proud of the work that we did for this. So next up is His Dark Materials. Last year, we worked on this show alongside our colleagues in the film team across both the London and the Montreal offices. My department worked on about 50 shots across 3 of the episodes in season 2. And as you can see from these breakdowns here, the work that we delivered ranged from creating full CG environments to extending live action sets and props, as well as creating lots of magical type effects and simulations. We also had a great opportunity to create one of the many wonderful creatures that feature in this show. And the creature that we were tasked with creating was a ringtail lemur. And here she is. Even though our lemur didn't play a particularly starring role within the series, we knew that she was going to be sharing the screen with one of the other hero characters who'd already been developed and established in season 1 of the show. And because the standard and the quality of the creatures that was already set from season 1 and obviously going into season 2, it was such a high standard that we knew that our asset had to at least match that same high level of work. The demons, as they're called in the story, they have their own characters and personalities. They're not just regular animals. So for me, it was really important to understand who our lemur was, to help make her come alive across through our renders and the shots that she was in. So for example, I knew that she lived most of her life up in an observatory high up in the mountaintop. So I thought it would be quite an interesting feature to make one of her eyes ever so slightly bigger than the other, to lean into the idea that she's always peering through the telescope, keeping an eye and spying on everyone in the cities down below. I learned quite early on that when developing any kind of character, it's usually a good idea to get your asset moving and animating as soon as possible, so you can start testing out all the different aspects of the asset. So it's important to create some kind of animation cycle to test all of these things on. No, not this one. Although this is quite fantastic in itself. This is more of the type of thing I'm talking about. So we created what we call an animation vignette, and that's what this is here. We use this as a test bed to iterate all the various aspects and facets that make up our asset. So we use it to help us develop our rig and animation techniques and see how our skin is deforming, how our fur is reacting to the light, and developing the look dev and so on and so forth. It's also a really nice way to present our work to the clients. It's a good way for them to see the asset moving and deforming and behaving in the way that's going to be indicative to how the final creature is going to look in the show. Of course, creating these animation vignettes can be quite time consuming. So if you can't do something like that, having kind of a standard walk cycle is, again, it's a really good way to push and pull and test all the different aspects of your asset. Here's that bit of reference footage that we used to base our walk cycle on. So as with the stag, our lemur presented her own set of challenges. And one of the main things that I thought was really important to get right was to get a sense of this really thick, dense fur that covers their body. And not only that, was to see these parting lines that appear and disappear as the lemur's moving and deforming. You can see it in this reference footage here on the flank, on the side of the lemur, as he's reaching forwards and moving. You can see the fur is parting, is coming apart and then coming back together. And this is one feature that for me personally, I thought was really important to try to get right. Now, again, while studying our reference, it was quite clear that we didn't need to put as much effort into the underlying skin deformations as we did for the stag, for example. We're not seeing a lot of evidence of muscles flexing and tensing that's translating up into the fur. So the CFX pass that we did for the lemur was more about getting volume preservation as well as getting physically correct collisions and deformations on the top surface. We also had an extensive set of blend shapes feeding into the animation rig. This is one of them here, which I thought was quite a fun one to share. And this, of course, the animators could use to control some of these deformations that translated into the final thing. In terms of the look of the lemur, as I mentioned, it was vital for our asset to look as realistic as possible. So we put an incredible amount of effort and detail into all the various parts that make up this character. Here's a fun render. Early on, when we were exploring the different colors and saturation values in the eyes, I thought I'd stick this in there just because it's quite hypnotic to watch. Once we were happy with our asset, towards the end of the show, we thought it would be quite a fun task to recreate the reference footage of the walk cycle that we'd use. So this is our render here. And here's just the beauty render of the lemur. And as you can see, that the fur parting is really working quite well. You know, it's making quite a significant difference and helping to add realism to our lemur. So at this point here, I'm going to pass over to Gabriella, who's going to tell us a bit more about the technical aspects of how we achieve this.
Now I'm going to talk a little bit more about this other creature we made for the second season of His Dark Materials, and it's this ring-tailed lemur. This lemur is quite a funny creature. So sometimes you can see him standing on some unusual poses. It got like some funny movements and was a really nice character to work with. One of the main aspects on the ground is this super scraggly and dense coat of fur that goes all around his body. And whenever he's moving, we can see those parting lines opening and close, like reacting to the movement. In order to achieve the shader for him, we use the same setup as we use on stag or color mask or probabilistic masks. And they were combined with root to tip different colors. So on his back, he has this darker layer of fur. And we got like stripes of white fur on it, especially on the tips. And this brings quite an interesting effect. So we used a lot of those probabilistic masks to drive it, combine extra masks plugged on it. So here you can see the first test that I made for this lemur on the parting. Before that, we didn't have a setup to create partings dynamically. We could create in parting lines on Houdini, but they didn't react to any kind of movement. So this was the first project we actually developed a tool for that. And because it wasn't Houdini, this tool was able to be created in 3 weeks' time. So it was a short time for a development that me and Philip, our R&D, were responsible for creating this from scratch for this show. Our parting groom tool can work in two different ways. So it can work on a static environment and a dynamic environment. When we're talking about the static environment, is where we actually combing the guides and grooming it. It's on the rest pose. So I can actually draw guides on it and the hair is going to be parted. And the other situation is it's going to open and close those partings based on the movement he's doing. So the lemur had some permanent partings, the ones that it was always there independent of movement. Those are smaller ones and less noticeable, especially around the face. And the big ones are driven by the animation. Our parting tool is different from the normal workflow because it takes some things into consideration. One of them is the distance between one parting line and the other. It's taken into account to detect like how much the hairs are going to be pushed. So it never lets the hairs from one side to cross to the other side of the parting and creating a mess. So they are actually going to collide with each other. And this is made without any kind of simulation. It's made on a sub level. We got like this collision detection that is based on proximity and is also based on the length of the hair. And you can also have control of that with an extra mask if you need to. The great thing about this is this detection of collision doesn't really need a mask, so you don't have to actually paint like on the mask. This opening amount and values is going to be automatically calculated for you if you want to. And the way it calculates when it's going to open or not on the dynamic side is based on skin stretchiness. And for that, we use a more sophisticated algorithm than just detecting the rest size of the polygons and the anim size. So that was the main aspects about the lemur groom. In the end, it was a super fun project to work with, and it's really nice to see him getting into life.
Thanks, Gabriella. And once again, as with the stag, you can see from the credits list here, we had an incredibly small team of artists working on this asset. And again, at the end, everyone was very happy and very proud of the work that we've delivered. And that brings us to the end of the presentation. So thank you all for watching. Thanks again to SideFX for inviting us once again to speak for you. And a huge thanks to all the artists and producers and technical team that helped us deliver all of this wonderful work that we looked at here today. So thank you once again. Until next time.